Welcome to another edition of Anything But Wrestling, except this is sort of Anything But Wrestling, because we will talk wrestling. My guest at this time is the wonderful Alexxis Falcon. How are you?
Hello, I'm good, are you?
Yeah, all right. Not bad. So, let's get to know you a little bit first before we talk about everything else. You're born in Hull.
Yeah.
And you're in Manchester now.
No, I'm in Liverpool. No,
you're in Liverpool, sorry.
Yeah.
We'll get there. So just kind of how did you get from Hull to Liverpool?
Moved here for uni 5 years ago and then just stayed. Okay. I still call the bar my bread cake there. I talk with like a little bit of a Scouse accent now.
Yeah.
But I'll still say like and no and Kirk. So it's like a really hot, sorry if you can hear my dog there. It's like a really horrible mix between the two.
Okay. So I was in Liverpool for like 18 years, so it's fine. I don't
Whereabouts
think I picked...
in Liverpool was you?
I lived in South Liverpool, right in Walton.
I live in South Liverpool.
Where do you live?
Oh. Hillwood.
Not too far away.
It's not the posh bit. Definitely not the posh bit of South Liverpool.
So what did you study at uni?
I did psychology.
Right. Okay. Cool. Okay. So wrestling, how did you get into it?
So I always watched it since I was a little kid. I used to watch it with my late granddad. And then... yeah, just I was at uni and I hated all my housemates. I've told this story so many times. I dread to think if they ever listen to this, like any podcast that
I still see them
or anything that I'm on. No, do I hell? Like, honestly, I've fucking blocked them off everything. Okay. I hated them all. It was all proper cranks. Like, you didn't know what mood they were going to wake up in. And in the end, I was like, do you know what? I need something to get me out of the house on like a Saturday, because like Monday to Friday you're in uni, so it didn't really matter. Yeah. And like Monday to Friday is also student night. So I started training. After Christmas, we'd gone on a Christmas break and I just turned to my mum like while I was home and I just said, I'm going to start wrestling now because like if I don't do it now, I never will. And I didn't want to start any like courses, like extra courses at uni because it was all, I used to be a gymnast when I was like 15, well, until I was about 15, 16. Mm. So I'd stopped it for the 2 years that I was at college, so sixth form. And then I was like, it's too late, like I'm too old to be going back into gymnastics. And the rest of the stuff was like rugby and hockey. Right. And
proper, like, I can't imagine you playing rugby. Sports.
Yeah, it was all like real posh sports, like what posh people did. And I was like proper not a posh person. So I just started wrestling like on the sides every Saturday and went from there.
Right, so where did you train?
Runcorn Wrestling Academy. Yeah.
Okay. So I
don't train there anymore.
Yeah, I had friends that trained there. That's all I'll say.
Yeah, okay.
Actually, the first ever wrestling show I went to was there.
Really?
Yeah. This was
I mean, like, I met some really good friends from there. I met some really good friends, but like, obviously, with the whole thing with speaking out that has happened, I was basically shut the school down. I feel really bad, like, because I didn't want to. I'd never wanted like any of my friends who I'd met like lifelong friends from that school. I won't knock all the people that go there because some people were really nice to me. Yeah. I didn't get on very well with the trainer towards the end, and there was a lot of like belittling of me to his trainees, which people who I was friends with would tell me about. And then I know that there were people who used to like laugh along, but to be absolutely fair, like they did message me when the whole speaking out thing happened, like they did message me privately and say like, I'm really sorry. And I think it takes like a really big person to do that. Like sometimes I think, would I do that? And honestly, I don't think I would, because I'm a little bit stubborn. So I did appreciate that some of them messaged me to say that they were sorry and stuff. Mm. But things turned pretty sour there, but
yeah,
it's closed down now, which I think, to be honest, is the best thing for British wrestling. So.
So we'll kind of come back to the speaking out thing a bit later, because let's kind of carry on a happier note for now.
Yeah, please.
So obviously you studied psychology, so I guess that really, really helped you with actually wrestling and like interacting with fans and stuff. No?
Absolutely not.
Really? Okay.
So I don't think so. I think with my course at uni, it was so different, and truth be absolutely told, I can't remember anything I learned. Like, Okay. As soon as I got that piece of paper on graduation that I'd spent 45 grand on, I was just like, do you know what? Like, what did I actually learn? I went to uni with the idea that I was going to be like a famous clinical psychologist and I was going to study mental health and in particular schizophrenia. And I wanted to study like the effects of schizophrenia, of drugs, like schizophrenic drugs and how that impacts people. And I had my full career plan set out and I was like, if that fails or I don't enjoy it, I'm going to go into forensic psychology. I'm going to like, you know, be that person who like goes and investigates a crime scene. And then when I got to uni and I figured that you have to do like another 5 years, I was like, do you know what? I'm so done with education now. Like, I was sick of being poor. I didn't get like the full uni experience in like second and third year. So it was just like, it was just one of those where I was just like, I'm not enjoying it anymore. I was always very much like at school and college, I was very like, I love like learning. I was a little bit of a geek. I revised quite a lot. I was really determined to get good grades. And then when it got to like after second year in uni, I was like, I do not care. Like the amount of times I used to ring my mum telling her I was coming home and dropping out was honestly a jerk. So I was just like bored of not earning money. And then obviously wrestling took off as well when I was in like third year. That's when it really started taking off. So it was just at the point where I was like, do I really want to be like, you know, pursuing a career down that road when like my end goal is to wrestle full time? Yeah. And the only way for me to ever do that was to then go and get a full time job so that I could afford to pay for stuff like new gear and pay for training. Because when I was a student, like I got like the lowest income, you know, like the lowest student grant that you could get. So I literally had no money to do anything. Like some weeks I didn't even have money to eat, never mind train. So it was just like one of those where I was like, I need to just earn money so I can train. I know it's kind of like, because I work full time now, sometimes I'll do a late shift, which I can't train that week. But I think it's I'm in much more of a stable training routine now and able to do more shows than I was when I was at uni. Because I used to feel guilty doing shows, like if I had an exam that week. Do you know what I mean? Whereas now I'm like, oh, well, I'll just be tired for work. I'm what? I'll just have a monster. I'll be fine. Whereas I couldn't really do that with an exam that I was paying like thousands of pounds to sit.
So how old are you now?
I'm 23 now, just 10.
So when did you finish uni? 2 years ago?
2 years ago, yeah. 20, what year are we in?
I don't even know.
2018, I finished.
Okay. So, and you work, we won't mention the company name, you just work in a bank.
Yeah, I work for a bank. Most people know what bank I work for, but probably get sacked if they heard me like add their name mentioned.
They know that you wrestle.
So like my team and managers do, and my old, because I used to work in business banking, where I worked, and now I work in like, I don't know the way to say this without giving away the company I work for. I work in like the higher end banking, so like banking corporate. Kind of like corporate banking, like richer people, kind of, if that makes sense. Like people with a lot of money. So like my team and the people who like know me at my work know that I'm a wrestler. My old manager, who in business, he absolutely loved wrestling. And as soon, this is really bad this, but as soon as he found that I was a wrestler, he was like, oh my God, give her the job. And I was like, oh my God, you can't, like, what if I was rubbish in my interview? Luckily I wasn't. Like the team leader at the time who interviewed me said it was a really good interview. But my old like higher up, like the market leader of that department, he was like, because he loved wrestling so much, he was like, oh my God, give her the job. I love wrestling. I want a wrestler to work here.
So where do you train now?
I train at Futureshock with Sam Bailey.
Ah, literally round the corner from where I am.
Oh, really?
Literally, yeah. I live, I'm not going to say it on a podcast where I live, but I live within walking distance from the Longfield Suite.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. And I interviewed Sonna Durson in McDonald's around the corner, so that was fun. Bit weird. So what's it like training with Futureshock? Because they've got a really good reputation.
I absolutely love it. Like, honestly, I think Sam's like so nice. And he also, I've also trained at Fighting Spirit a couple of times with the Grizzled Young Vets, so Zach and JD. They're really lovely as well. Like they've got different levels of feedback that I wasn't getting from Runcorn. Like they give you such in detail feedback and like pick you on the like minor little tiny details that otherwise you would never know to change. Do you know what I mean? And I've also had training sessions with like Damon Lee. Sonas took a few training sessions a couple of times. So you learn from like a whole different range of people rather than the same person every week, which I got from my first training school. But I do love training at Futureshock. I love everybody there. Sam's really sound. So yeah.
So who else trains with you? Not teacher-wise, but like actual students.
So my partner, JJ Webb, we're like a duo at Futureshock as well. Like he trains with me. Tonga trains there. Loads, like honestly, loads of people. Like most of like you young guns, they train there as well. Lewis, so Scott Urban, he trains there. There's so many people who train there, like are on like Northwest shows a lot.
Yeah, it must also help to have such a talented class to actually train with as well.
Oh. I think it does, because like at the minute we're in pairs because of coronavirus, like you've got to train in your pairs like for the full session, but pre-COVID I would definitely say like it pushes you to be better when you're in the ring with people who are definitely above your ability level.
Right, so actually that's a good point, you just mentioned coronavirus and training. How has it all changed? What is the protocol these days?
So like we've got I think they do 3 sessions a day now so that it can be split into smaller classes. So instead of doing one evening session, they'll do a morning, an afternoon and an evening. As well, because a lot of people are on furlough or have lost their jobs, unfortunately, because of coronavirus, so that they can do the daytime. There's more training sessions throughout the week as well. I think there's 4 nights that you can train. You have to stay in your pairs and you have to pre-book on an app. So you have to book your slot, and if it's full, like you can't go.
Okay, so who's your partner for the training?
JJ.
Oh, right. That's handy. Okay.
Well, we live together, and I was, like, classed as high risk. So I didn't go outside for, like, the first 6 weeks of coronavirus. Oh, wow. I was meant to stay in for a little bit longer, but oh well. but I was a little bit nervous going back to training. Truth be told, I was really, really scared. So I've only worked with James so far because we literally live together, and it makes the most sense for us to be partnering to get together, because we're literally getting in really close contact.
Right,
we sleep in the same bed. So
so given that this is anything but wrestling, let's not talk about wrestling for a minute. How have you found the past like 5 months and lockdown and all that kind of stuff? Not talking about speaking out. Speaking out to the side for now.
No, that's fine. I found it really hard at first. So I stay inside for a really long time, so I'm quite badly asthmatic, and I also have B12 deficiency, which means that I've got a bit of a weak immune system. I've got too much stuff wrong with me, like you name it, I've got it. So I shielded myself for about 6 to 8 weeks before I then decided that I was going to like go to the shops. I know that's really bad, but it was annoying me that James was just bringing back the wrong brand of food, like not Heinz ketchup. I'm real fussy eater, so I'd see my ass about it. So in the end, I just started going out. But like, truthfully, I put on a stern during lockdown. I was eating really badly. I had 3 trips to Disney cancelled. Like, literally. And I know that sounds really daft. And there was so much worse things going on than people's Disney trips being cancelled. And I completely get it. But then at the same time, because a lot of people said to me, was like, oh God, like, why are you so annoyed about your Disney trip being cancelled? But like, at the same time, like, you spend thousands of pounds to go there. You months and months of planning go into it. Everybody knows I'm a massive Disney fan anyway. And I'd not been for 2 years. And the last time I'd been was with my ex-boyfriend. And we were in a little bit of a volatile relationship anyway. So it wasn't the best Disney trip I've ever had. Do you know what I mean? So I was really looking forward to having like the best time. Like, I'm supposed to be there in 2 weeks today. I was supposed to be flying to Florida. Okay. So everybody's like, I know everybody's like, oh, there's worse things going on. But like, for me, it was really depressing. Literally so depressing. We've booked a holiday to Paris, Disneyland Paris, for 2 weeks' time, because we did it on a whim. We literally did it, like 3 days ago, we did it on a whim. But I rang the actual Disney club, because we booked it directly through Disney, because I know there's been a lot of umming and ahhing about people getting their money back. But with Disney, you do get your money back within 5 days, guaranteed. So I was like, do you know what? If we'll just book it, and if we don't go, we get our money back, and we can just buy each other more Christmas presents. And if we do go, we go, and I won't be as depressed that I'm missing out on Florida. Yeah. But, and I didn't see any of my family either. So like a lot of the time my mum comes up. Mm. Didn't speak to me. Didn't see her for like 5 months.
Wow.
Was it 5? No, it wasn't 5 months. It was about 3 months.
Right. It all started in March, so.
Yeah, so I'd seen her in March, and then I didn't see her again until like my birthday, I don't think, which was July. So, a little bit sad. Yeah, I just didn't really like it, to be honest. I was, I felt like I was getting cabin fever, and now I'm working from home, so it's even worse. Like, I feel like I'm working where I sleep, and I'm sleeping where I work. Yeah. So.
So, what have you been doing to kind of keep you happier and not kind of dwelling on all that?
So, during lockdown, I took up like quite a few different things. So, I took up baking, and so I did a lot of baking, which is probably where the stern came from. But
we'll I wasn't going to say it, but
we'll gloss over that though. I started doing a lot of colouring in as well. So, at the very, very start, I had real bad anxiety, and like I could feel myself getting like really worked up and upset like every single day. So I started writing like a diary and colouring in as well, and playing lots of Animal Crossing and doing yoga with Adrian on YouTube, which by the way is fab if you've not done it. So that was like that was all I really did during lockdown, to be honest.
Right. Okay. And now as you're kind of allowed out a bit more, what are you doing to kind of get a bit more normality?
I'm going to the gym more than I've ever been the gym before. I'm going like 5 times a week. I've never been that much. My mum's here right now, which is the dog that you heard earlier. So my mum's here, she's brought the dog. So
I was gonna say, you just said my mum's here, which is the dog that you just heard. I was gonna say
she's gonna kill me if she listens to this. No, she's got a dog and she's brought her dog.
Okay. You're a cat person, aren't you?
Yeah, I love cats. I love cats and dogs.
Do you have cats?
Yeah,
I was gonna. Yeah, okay. Because I was gonna say I've seen pictures. I don't know why I asked why.
They're BFFs, like Lila and Boo. Lila's my cat. Yeah. I've uploaded this to Instagram. I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah. Oh,
that's them too.
That's cute.
That was earlier. Yeah. They're so cute. They're literally my faves.
Oh, okay. So during lockdown, to go kind of down in the mood, speaking out happened. Do you want to talk me through kind of your thoughts on it, how it progressed, and kind of where you think things should go and where things are at now?
Yeah, so it's so weird at the minute, because how it all started was that David Starr, his ex-girlfriend, basically outed him. And at the time, there was me, Sierra Loxton, Gio Adams and Tonga, who was very, very vocal about it that night. Now, I turned around to my boyfriend and I was like, I could lose bookings over this. Because at the time I thought like I potentially could. I don't think it was until like maybe 2 or 3 days later that everyone started getting on it, and when they realized how like in support people were of us doing it and sharing our own stories and voicing our support for David Starr's victim, I don't think it was until then that people then not jump on the bandwagon, that's completely the wrong word to use, but like really started jumping on and giving support. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then sharing their own experiences, and it got really overwhelming. Like I didn't eat for days. I didn't sleep for days. I literally forgot to brush my teeth and shower for like 2 days. Like James was my absolute support system, to be fair. Like I don't think I could have asked for any more off him. And I think with what happened to me, he knew about the Andy stuff, but some of the other stuff that he didn't know, well, he knew of, but I don't think he knew like really how far it went. And I think like that must have been horrible for my fella to read on Twitter. Story that, do you know what I mean?
Yeah. So
it then started blowing up. And I think like with the way things are now, I think there's a lot of talk around shows shouldn't be running again and people shouldn't be looking forward to going back to wrestling. And I think that's really wrong. I think it's really, really wrong and quite toxic to be saying that. I think the only way that we can go back to a new normal is by running shows again and making sure that like there needs to be trial and error with this. Nobody's going to get it perfect the first time. And no one's like, I'm meant to have a show next week, lockdown permitting. With Futureshock, and then I've got one for TNT at the end of October. They're not going to get it perfect, and no one's expecting them to. And I think there's so much pressure on them right now from fans and people who work within the industry who are really like looking at them under a microscope, and I don't think that's fair. They've done all that they can in terms of appointing safeguarding officers, having safeguarding policies, making sure that people who are outed abusers are not booked. As far as I know, because I know that there's abusers who haven't been outed yet, as far as I know, on the next, because I'm in like a group chat which has got the
card. I was going to say, don't mention any specifics for legal.
Yeah, I'm not going to mention anything, like any names or anything. But as far as I know, everybody in that group chat, there's not one person in there who's been, like, you know, outed or even privately outed, where maybe the public don't know about it. Do you know what I mean? So, like, I just think that there needs to be a little bit less, like, oh, people shouldn't be looking forward to going back to wrestling, because how are people ever going to, like, what people have got to remember is, like, yeah, there was these horrible people within wrestling, but we want to go back. I want to go back and wrestle. Like, my friends want to go back and wrestle. So, and I think that's fine. Like, of course we're going to look forward to going back wrestling again. Like, it's what we've lived and breathed for the last God knows how long.
Yeah.
So now it's just a little bit weird, because I think a lot of, I don't envy companies at all at the minute. I think wrestlers, companies are under scrutiny. I'm scared of the backlash I'm going to get for potentially doing these shows if they go ahead with Corona. Like, and it's not a healthy environment or place to be in. Like,
yeah,
everyone's just jumping down everyone's throat at the minute. And I think you just need to let shows happen and then see where they go from there. Like, you can't get everything within what Speaking Out happened in what, June?
Yeah.
How are you going to get things sorted by then? And you can't sit there and go, oh, well, you shouldn't run until it's all perfect, because you're never going to get things perfect. Like, even shows before all this happened was never, ever perfect. Like, there was always something that didn't happen. Someone's music either wasn't working, or someone forgot their gear, or someone didn't show up and they needed to find a last-minute replacement.
Yeah.
It's the same with everything. Like, no day ever goes smoothly. No show ever goes smoothly. And I think, like, there was a thing as well I'd seen on Twitter about people, you know, saying, oh, there's shows that are running, let's all go to the council and tell them that they're booking abusers.
Yeah.
The council are not interested in wrestling. They're not going to look at which is a bad wrestler and which is a good wrestler. They're just going to think, oh, wrestling must be shit then. We're not letting them run here again. And then that's so many good people who are out of work. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So for now, I would just say that we just need to play it out. Like, we've done all that we can. People are being spoken out against, actions being taken, police have been involved for some people, and I know that there is some abusers who have wormed their way back in, and some people who have just had a slap on the wrist. But what fans and wrestlers need to do is, instead of complaining, they need to turn their backs, let the promoters know that that person is not wanted at that show, and that's the only real way to get rid of them. Reporting them to the council is just going to cause more damage, I think.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, people like you, or, you know, Mariah May, people like that, you want to get back in the ring. You want to perform at shows.
100%.
You know, it's not up to the fans in a way. It's up to you guys who have been directly affected by this, whether you want to get back in the ring or not.
It's not my problem that somebody, that there's God knows how many nonces out there. Like, sorry for my language there, but, like, it's not, that's not my issue.
Yeah.
I've not done it. Yeah. Why am I suffering the damages? Like, I've already suffered enough with what I've been through. These girls have already suffered enough, and men have suffered as well. Like, it's not just strictly thingy limited to women.
Yeah.
Men have suffered as well. Why are we now not able to wrestle, or not even able to look forward to wrestling because of somebody else's actions? Like, we've already been abused. Let us have summer. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And now you've got, like, Parliament involved as well. Are you hopeful for the future of the industry that it will clean? Obviously, it's not going to clean up 100%. Nothing ever will. You know, professional football's got it, you know.
Literally, yeah.
You know, are you confident for the future, though?
That it won't get better? I am. I really am. I think that the whole movement was a point where I was like, right, this is, like, things are changing now. Like, we've had enough of your shit. We're calling it out. The person I outed deleted me on Facebook 3 days before I outed him, when the whole David Starr stuff kicked off. He knew it was coming. He knew, like, I'm sorry, like, you're just nerd, yeah. Like, he knew it was going to happen. And I think, like, there were a lot of people who were, like, shaking in their boots, and so they fucking should have been. Like, I do feel hurtful for it. Like you say, you're never going to get it perfect, never. Yeah. And that's horrible to say, and I feel sad saying that.
Yeah.
But you get them in schools, teaching our kids, you get them in football, rugby, there's probably one working at your local Asda. It literally just is what it is. They're like, you're never going to get rid of all of them until action is taken. And unfortunately, they're going to be in all walks of life. And it's just a case of everyone coming together and getting them out that way. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So you're back in the ring in 2 weeks for Future Shock.
What day is it today? 8 days, the 20th.
That's in Stockport, isn't it?
Yep. It'll be next Sunday.
Who are you facing?
I can't say just yet.
Oh, they've not announced it?
Not yet.
Okay, fine.
Somebody I've wrestled before.
Okay. And then after that, you are with TNT in Liverpool wrestling Lizzie.
Yep.
Tell me about that, because Lizzie had fighting words for you on our podcast that I did with her. So go on.
In all honesty, I'm really, really looking forward to that match. And I know that this, you probably want the whole, like, oh, I'm going to fucking kick her head in, which I will kick her head in, like, but she's going to batter me as well. And I'm so excited for it. Like, I've been wanting to wrestle Lizzie for as long as I can remember. And I think, like, it's just going to be so good. I'm so, so excited. Like, literally, I'm like, TNT is one of my favourite companies to work for. In the real world, I absolutely love Lizzie to pieces. I absolutely love her. She's such an angel.
Yeah.
And I just know it's going to be a really good match. And I know we're going to fucking knock 10 bells of shit out of each other. And I'm so looking forward to it.
So she, when I talked to her, she said she's kind of tweaked her character and she's got a few surprises up her sleeve for when she comes back. Have you made any changes or is it, you know?
A little bit. I've before lockdown happened, I was working on some new moves. And then lockdown happened and I think I've forgot how to do them.
Okay.
But yeah, I've got some new wrestling gear, so okay. New look. And I'll probably do my roots because, you know.
I was going to say, what colour hair?
I'll always stay red. The other day I did have like a bit of a like 23-year-old midlife crisis because I was like, I'm going to dye my hair black. I'm not going to be red anymore. But then I just think I need to stay red forever.
Yeah. What's the story with the red? Why is it red?
So everybody thinks that I do it to look like... So when I first did it, everybody was like, oh, yeah, it really matches your wrestling character. Like, you like this, like, punk rock chick. And I'm like, yeah, that's totally why I did it. I primarily did it to look like Ariel, the Little Mermaid. That's literally the only reason.
That's just taking your character and totally destroying it.
Everybody knows that I love Disney. Like, literally everyone knows it. Even the people who, like, boo the shit out of me will know that I still sit there in fully as, not as Alexxis, but as Alex, doing my Disney vlogs with my little Minnie Mouse ears on. Like, they all know that I do that. But I'm not bothered. I think you need to show a bit of vulnerability, don't you?
Yeah. I was going to say, like, they always say in wrestling, your character is you dialed up to, like, 11. But if it was you dialed up to 11, you'd just be a Disney princess coming down to the ring, essentially.
I know. Well, funnily enough, my best mate, Chloe, she's from Hull. She's not a massive wrestling fan. Mm. And when I, like, first started, she just looked at me. She's brutally honest. And she was like, I don't think you could ever be a babyface, though. Like, you just look like a cow. Okay. And I was like, thanks, nice. Chloe. She's like, you do, though. She's like, you just look like a little bit of a bitch. I just want to boo you. Which is fair enough, and I think I do play heel a whole lot better than I play babyface because my literal babyface is just me as a Disney princess, like living my best life. But that is probably me in real life, to be honest, because I look like a bitch, but I act like a princess.
Fair enough. I suppose when you're facing Lizzie, she's in her hometown. I mean, it's kind of like your adopted hometown, so who is the heel?
It's a bit weird. Yeah, it's a little bit weird. I think it's going to be a little bit down the middle, to be honest.
Interesting. Okay. So what are your kind of hopes for the future for like the next, say, 5 years?
I don't know. I really want to go to Japan. I say this all the time. I really want to go to Japan. Or go across to America to wrestle. Oh. And hopefully get a WWE tryout. But
okay. Is NXT UK?
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's what I was hoping for. I would hope that I'd get an NXT UK tryout at least.
Right.
I think I'd be a little bit disappointed with myself if I didn't, but I don't want to come back and listen to this interview in 5 years' time and be like, sat there like 28 stone, eating some butterkissed popcorn, crying. Yeah. But yeah,
have they ever been in contact with you?
That's no, all.
Right, okay, fair enough. So away from the ring, like, what, you know, if it, well, I hope it does work out. If it doesn't work out, like, where do you want to be? What do you want to do? That kind of thing.
I haven't really thought about that. I suppose the only way I would ever kind of stop is if I was either, like, too old, like, to the point where, like, my body literally couldn't take it. I don't really want, I don't want children, so that's not really, I've never thought, oh, I'll have to stop at, like, 32 because I'll want kids, because I genuinely don't want kids. I'm really weird. I'm one of those girls who, like, I dream about getting married, and, you know, like, they always say, like, oh, once you get married, you have to have kids. Mm. I'm like, no. Like, I know what my wedding dress looks like, but I don't want kids. So
hold on, hold on. Pause. You already know what your wedding dress looks like. Yeah. You're not engaged.
No.
Okay, fine.
I know. Carry so on. we need James to listen to this interview.
Yeah, if there's a wedding, like, the whole TWM crew are now invited. Whether yeah, you like 100%. It or not.
100%. But, yeah, so I just don't want kids. So that's not an issue for me. The only way I'd ever stop is if I was, like, literally too old and my body couldn't continue, or for whatever reason I got injured.
Right.
So, I mean, I suppose if I got injured tomorrow and I could never wrestle again, I would probably say I want to be working for the bank that I am working for now in New York.
Okay.
They have a big headquarters in New York. Without giving away the bank that I work for, they have a massive headquarters in New York, and I'd love to live in America. It's an absolute dream. That, or I could be Ariel in the parks. Yeah. I could pretend to be Ariel.
Yeah, just be one of those kind of fake mermaids that dive into the tank every so often.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Cool. Okay, we're gonna do a quick fire round to end this all off. So I'm going to ask you a series of questions. It's literally just like one word answers. Okay.
Oh God, I'm scared.
No, it's just stuff about you. It's fine. Don't worry. Okay. So favorite TV show.
Gossip Girl.
Why?
I love it. I've seen it so many times. I've just told you I've dreamed about living in New York. Yeah, like.
Okay. Favorite band. I'm going to clip that noise you just made. I'm going to put that on Twitter. Right, carry on.
I don't know.
Okay, give me your top three.
I honestly don't know. I'm not like a massive... this is going to sound so cliche. AC/DC?
Okay, that's acceptable. It'll do.
I'm going to say them.
Okay. What song do you want as your first song at your wedding?
I can't tell you. It's cringy.
Go on.
No, I can't tell you.
Okay. Oh, who's it sung by?
It's a secret. Ed Sheeran.
Okay. fine. Football team?
Hull City.
That's fun on the opening day of League One.
Duh, I'm really upset. All the people like outside my house was like properly celebrating, like when Liverpool got, when they won the Premier League, and yeah, it's just been crazy. And I was made up, like I'm not one of those people who absolutely hate Liverpool. I know everybody seems to hate Liverpool. I really don't. I don't care. Yeah. Probably because I'll see you fucking shit, but that's why.
But to be fair, you did win 2-0 today. So.
Well, you know, swings and roundabouts. Yeah. So I was just sat there really depressed because Hull City had been relegated to League One.
Yeah. Anyway. So, favourite opponent?
Charlie Evans.
Okay, good choice. Favourite promotion?
I've got two.
Go on.
Futureshock and TNT.
Okay, that was kind of obvious, to be fair.
Yeah.
Favourite promotion to watch?
Eve.
Okay. Have you wrestled for Eve before?
Nope.
Is that kind of on the list?
I hope so.
Okay, cool. Who you would like to manage you if you could pick anyone in the world?
Oh, anyone in the world? I was going to ask for Paul Heyman, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay.
Imagine having somebody picking a manager and it not being Paul Heyman.
Favorite wrestler of all time?
Jeff Hardy.
Favorite British wrestler? Male.
William Regal.
Yeah. Favorite female?
British or non-British?
British.
Layla? She was British.
True.
I know she spoke with an American accent near the end, but she was definitely British.
Yeah. Okay, favourite non-British female?
I want to say Lita, but it's definitely Charlotte Flair now. She's took the top spot.
Fair enough. Okay. Cats or dogs?
Cats.
Good choice. Lovely. All right. That is a good place to end it. Thank you very much for speaking to me.
Thank you for having me.
Last thing, what's all your social media stuff? Tell the people.
So Instagram, Alexxis Falcon with two X's, not one. And Twitter is the same, Alexxis Falcon. And then I also have a Facebook page, which I never really post on. So
actually, that's a really good question to end on. Why is it two X's?
I don't know. I actually don't know. I think I just decided I wanted two X's. And yeah, I just like the look of two X's. So
I was expecting something really philosophical, but
then there's not really anything to it.
No. Okay. All right. Brilliant. Thank you very much.
Thank you.